Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, Life Church. I don't know about you, but I'm glad to be in the service one more time. Come on and help me sing about how the Lord has resurrected us. Come on.
I was buried beneath my shame.
My Lord.
Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb.
Yeah.
Till I met you.
Hallelujah.
I was breathing but not alive.
Yes, Lord.
All my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I met you. When you call my name, you call my name, and I ran out of that grave. Oh Lord, out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Hey, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, sing with me.
That your mercy has saved my soul.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
And your freedom is all that I know.
Yeah.
The old man knew Jesus when I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave. Out of
story. This is our song, praising our Savior all the day long. Come on, everybody sing.
I needed rescue. My sin was heavy, but chains break at the weight of your glory. I needed shelter. I was an orphan, but you called me a citizen of heaven. When I was broken, you were my healer. Now your love is the air that I'm breathing. I have a future. My eyes are open. 'Cause when you call my name,
snatched us out of the pit. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, we searched all over and we still couldn't find nobody like you, Lord. Hallelujah.
I've searched the world. But it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along.
Yeah.
And put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love.
Yeah.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing.
Hey,
nothing is better than you.
Ah. Hallelujah.
I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all and you still call me friend.
Hallelujah.
'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. And there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
Come on, I tried a lot of things. I know you have too. Come on, say.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
Hey, we thank you, God. Hey,
you turn morning to day.
Hallelujah. Nothing is better than my Savior. Nothing is better than my Redeemer. Come on, say.
Nothing. Oh, there's nothing. Yeah. Oh, there's nothing. Nothing is
better than Jesus. Nothing is better than Jesus.
Who can? Hey, you're the only.
Well, praise the Lord, everybody. Pastor Ashley here, and happy Sunday. Thank you to our worship team that has been leading us into the presence of the Lord. We appreciate your consistency and faithfulness in ministry. Well, welcome. Welcome, Life Church. Welcome, family. Welcome, friends, and especially welcome to our visitors. We know there are many services you could have tuned into today, and we don't think it by chance that you've tuned into our broadcast. And we pray that God ministers to your heart as the Word of God is being preached. If you have not done so already, take a moment and connect with us. Subscribe to our YouTube page. Follow us on Facebook and Instagram. We look forward to connecting with you. Well, we do have a few announcements for you guys today. We will be resuming with our Bible study Tuesday at 7 p.m. You can join us via our YouTube, our Zoom link, or directly on Facebook. But join us as we unpack God's Word together. Also, remember to join us Thursday at 7 p.m. for prayer. You can join us via our Zoom link, and it is always great to come together and to call on the name of the Lord with the saints. So join us Thursday at 7 p.m. for prayer. Also want to bring to our attention that Pastor Ben has created a video for us. This video explains where we are as a church and just clarifying some things that he wrote in his letter in the Pulse to the church. So when you have the chance, click the link. It should be found in the Pulse, but click the link so that you may be able to view the video and hear what God has laid upon his heart. We also have a women's and men's group coming up. Our women will be meeting on April the 24th, and our men will be meeting April 29th. The men will be meeting at my house, and we are grateful that as a church, we can fellowship together. So again, women will be meeting April 24th, and the men's fellowship will be on April 29th. Look forward to seeing you all there. And lastly, we will be having our family talk meeting on May the 1st. If you can, we want everyone to be there. We have a lot of things to talk about as a church and follow up our conversation from the last conversation that we had. So we definitely want everyone to be there. We had our last conversation in March. So join us May 1st, immediately following service on Zoom. Let's have our family talk. Let's talk about where we are as a church and let us have a great conversation. So look forward to seeing you all there after service May 1st. And now it is offering time. Time for us to give a portion to God that which he has given to us. A number is appearing on the screen. Take a moment and give to the Lord. And without further ado, we're going to have the word of God from our pastor, Pastor Benjamin Abdelrahmi. We know that God has placed a good word upon his heart. So get your notepad out, get your pen out, and let us go right into the word of the Lord.
Hello, Life Church. This is Pastor Ben here, and I'm grateful for another opportunity for us to be able to connect with one another through this virtual worship experience. It's my prayer that you all have been enjoying yourself so far and chatting with one another and sharing with people and liking the video and everything like that. And I'm very grateful for our time together today. I do want to reiterate some things that Pastor Ashley has said. Please check out the update and clarification video that I put in the Pulse. And also for those who will be meeting today for Women's Small Group, just know that I'll be there sharing with you guys about my time on sabbatical and hearing from you as well. All right, let's dive in to the Word of God today. I'm going to pray and then we'll continue. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for another opportunity for us to speak with you, for us to engage with you, for us to know you, for us to honor you through the hearing and the reading of your Word. Lord, I ask that you would allow for me to articulate correctly what your Word says and that it would affect the hearts and the minds of those who are hearing these sermons, Lord God. Bless Life Church to be encouraged and edified and strengthened from what is said, and hide me behind your cross as I lift up your holy word so that the person and work of Jesus would be ingrained deeper in our minds, our hearts, and our souls. Lord, we love you and we thank you for the privilege and the opportunity to be in your family and to be able to know your good and your perfect will. We ask, Lord, that you would use these moments for your glory and your glory alone. In Jesus' name I pray, amen and amen. All right. So we started a series, which I entitled the Resurrection Series. And we started this last Sunday because it was Resurrection Sunday. And the purpose of us extending the theme or idea of resurrection in the next coming Sundays that we have coming up and the next coming sermons that we have coming up was really to show that the message of the resurrection goes beyond Resurrection Sunday. That understanding the resurrection is critical for us in our everyday lives as Christians. And we should be seeking to learn and understand more and more about its significance. Last week, we looked at Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 9, and we saw the account of the angel giving the message to the women at the tomb that Jesus has risen. And from there, we begin this examination of the message of the resurrection. We realize that no one actually witnessed the resurrection. And in the scriptures, the actual resurrection event is not explained. However, the discovery of the resurrection is explained, and the message of the resurrection is what's lifted up. And this idea, this theme connects us with those who heard this message in ancient times, because that message of Jesus Christ, the risen Messiah, the message that Jesus Christ is not dead, that he has raised with all power, has been heralded from the moment we see the angel giving the message to the women at the tomb until today. From verses 1 through 6, we saw that the message of the resurrection impacts everything, and that the message of the resurrection interrupts our assisting a dead Jesus. We saw that the message of a resurrection immortalizes the words of Jesus, and the message of the resurrection invites examination. Today, we're going to look at verse 7. And we're going to see more that we can learn from the power of the word in explaining and breaking down and examining this particular message and why it is so critical to us as Christians today. I'm going to read the entire passage just so we can get context and be refreshed on that. And then we're going to go into verse 7 and see what the Lord has to show us about this powerful message. And it reads in the English Standard Version, Matthew 28, verses 1 through 9. Now, after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead, and behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. Verse 7. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. From verse 7, I believe we see, in continuing breaking down the message of the resurrection, we can see here that the message of the resurrection comes with a command to go and tell. The message of the resurrection comes with a command to go and tell. The angel lets the women know he is risen. Jesus Christ has raised from the dead. And he tells them, urgently, go quickly and tell the disciples. Isn't it amazing that from this very point of going and telling, we can see something that we have been doing throughout all of Christian history, going and telling that Jesus is risen. The angel does not suggest this. He commands this. And this brings about a very important point that we really want to get. Resurrection Sunday, we come together and we receive this message of the resurrection. But how many of us share that message? It's about more than just receiving the message of the resurrection. The good news that Jesus Christ is risen. There's a command that comes with this for those who follow Jesus. Hint at that. For those who follow Jesus. You know, the two Roman soldiers, they were passed out. Okay. So the command did not apply to them, but it did apply to the women who were followers of Jesus. Go and tell it. I believe that this is an encouragement for us today about sharing the truth that Jesus is risen to those who we encounter. In our social media posts, in our engagements with our friends, with our family, with non-believers, how many times are we really setting our minds to go and tell the message of the resurrection? This particular account in Matthew 28 is a foretaste of how the church would literally grow. It's a foretaste of evangelism, spreading the good news of Jesus Christ. Many of us look at Matthew 28 and we think of the go and make disciples, but there was a go before that go. And that was the command that the angel told the women at the tomb. And today, we still have a command to go and tell. Now, I know there may be some objections to this, right? Like if anybody knows the text, they can look at it and say, okay, we just read this and the angel is telling the women to go and tell the disciples. But are they being told to go and tell those who are non-believers? Are they being told to go and tell the world about Jesus? They're being told to go and tell disciples that Jesus is risen. How can that context apply to us today when I thought that the going and telling that Christians had to do today was to those who don't know Jesus? Well, let's put ourselves in the disciples' shoes for a moment. Be very clear. When the scripture here talks about the disciples, it's talking about those who walked with Jesus bodily. It's primarily dealing with the 11, okay? So these guys are in quite the predicament at this point in the text. Jesus was stripped away from them, publicly crucified, and now the leadership and Jews were looking for them to punish them. We know that the disciples were afraid of this because in John 20, verse 19, when we look at what was going on with the disciples after Jesus was crucified, it says that they were gathered with their doors locked for fear of the Jews. Jesus was crucified publicly, their leader, and now those who killed Jesus are on the hunt for the disciples. At this point in the narrative, the disciples, those who walked with Jesus, believe Jesus is dead. And if their leader is dead, then their movement is dead. Scripture shows that this wasn't something that was uncommon. A leader would rise up, have a big movement, die, and then the movement would die. The famous Pharisee, Gamaliel, we saw him while we were going through the book of Acts. He pointed this out, that this has happened before. Acts chapter 5, verse 36 through 39. Theodas rose up, claiming to be somebody, and a number of men, about 400, joined him. He was killed, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean rose up in the days of the census and drew away some of the people after him. He too perished, and all who followed him were scattered. This puts the disciples of Jesus in a place where there truly is a question mark on whether or not this movement is going to continue. They are in a situation where their leader is dead and they are being scattered, scared into one place. This is why the angel tells the women at the tomb to go let the disciples know that Jesus is not dead, he's alive. Because if their leader is alive, then the movement is alive as well. If the leader is alive, then there's encouragement to know that they can still get direction about what to do next, and the movement will still thrive. Can't we sometimes be like the disciples? We act like our leader is dead. Now, we talked about this last week a little bit when we dealt with trying to assist a dead Jesus. But there's another angle of this when we look at the disciples here, because we may not think that we act like our leader is dead in our actions. But what do our words look like? What do our countenance look like as Christians? Are we the type that looks at the state of the world and says, you know what? It looks like Christians are going down for the count. How can we possibly move forward in such tumultuous times like this? It looks like the movement has a question mark over it. This is how we are like the disciples. We are talking about the faith, about the ministry, like it may almost be done. It may not work out. It may be over. Who knows what'll happen? All the while, our Savior is risen. I want to encourage you guys this afternoon to know that because Jesus is alive, there is no opposition the Christian faith will ever come up against that will put a question mark on whether or not we will be successful. We should get encouragement for that today. It was critical that these women told the disciples Jesus is alive so they would stop being what? Locked in their doors, stationary and silent. And instead, they would be like the women who have received the message that Jesus is risen and are now running outside with great joy to tell others. Our movement is not dead because our Savior lives. Okay, you could look at this and say, okay, Pastor Ben, okay, you explained the connection between us and disciples receiving the message from the two women and the command of the message of the resurrection, or to tell the message of the resurrection to other disciples. But still, in the broader context for Christians today, the goal that we have been given for today is go and make disciples, right? It's called the Great Commission, and it's even in Matthew chapter 28. Y'all know it. Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." This is the go telling we have inherited as believers. It's not the go telling of the resurrection of Jesus. But here's the thing, before you go in that direction, you can't make disciples of Jesus without sharing the gospel, the good news of Jesus. And you can't share the good news of Jesus without sharing the resurrection of Jesus. This is why the go and telling of the women at the tomb, the message of the resurrection, precedes the Great Commission. Because the Great Commission depends on the message of the resurrection, depends on Jesus being raised from the dead. Let's look at an example of this. Look at how Paul summarizes the gospel and what he had received and delivered in 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. Now, I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, the good news of Jesus I preached to you, which you received and in which you stand and by which you are being saved. Get that? The gospel of Jesus Christ is the way in which people are saved. When someone is saved, they are made a what? Disciple of Jesus Christ, fulfilling the Great Commission. Here's what Paul continues to say. If you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received. So you see the pattern here, right? Just like the two women received the message and they were commanded to go deliver it, Paul continues that, right? He received this message and he's going to deliver it. He delivered it to those in Corinth. Here's what the message is. Paul breaks it down. That Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. This is the gospel. That Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. The gospel of Jesus Christ is the message that saves, in other words, makes disciples. And the gospel contains and depends on the message of the resurrection. Now, we got to get why it's so critical that the angel commanded these women to go and tell this particular message. Because here we would literally see the way in which people would be brought in to relationship with Jesus Christ. When someone is saved and they are made a disciple, they are brought from the dead spiritually. Get this. The message of the resurrection raises the spiritually dead. This is why we're commanded to say it. The message that Jesus is risen, which is the message that's a part of the package of the gospel, when people believe in that, they are made into new creations. They are raised from the dead spiritually. They are brought to life, to newness of life. This is why the angel was not giving a suggestion to these women, because this would be the pattern of the church for making new creations that would honor and glorify Jesus. So we are connected to this go and tell of these women at the tomb, because the going and making disciples is based off of going and telling of the risen Jesus. This message has more to it than we could ever imagine. And when we get that, we understand why it's so critical for us to go and tell it. Do you know that the message of the resurrection reveals Jesus's identity? It cements who he is as the Son of God. This is why we are commanded to go and tell that he is risen. Because from this message and from the sharing of this event that has taken place, we are inviting people to stand on the very foundation of the church. Matthew chapter 16, verse 15 through 18, Jesus is talking to his disciples and asking them what the people are saying or who the people are saying that he is. And Peter ends up getting it right. Let's take a look at it. But what about you? He asked. Who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this has not this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." This is a very, very important thing for us to get here, right? Because in this passage, we are seeing that Jesus himself said that the rock upon which the church would be built would be the confession and belief that Jesus is the Messiah and the Son of God. Well, how does this connect to the message of the resurrection? Paul reveals to us in Romans chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, that Jesus is confirmed as the Son of God by the resurrection. Romans chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures regarding his Son, who as to his earthly life was a descendant of David, and who through the Spirit of holiness was appointed the Son of God in power by his resurrection from the dead. When we share the message of the resurrection, the message that Jesus has raised from the dead, we are sharing the confirming event that cements Jesus's identity as the Son of God who will judge the entire world. And that understanding of who he is and what he has done by raising from the dead is the very foundation of the church. No wonder in the time and culture and context that we live in today, there are so many people trying to muzzle the church from talking about the fact that he is risen. No wonder there is such an attack on the message of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. There are so many trying to thwart and disprove that Jesus is risen, because if we are spreading the reality that Jesus is risen, then that means disciples, new creations are popping up left and right. That means that the message that Jesus is the Son of God is being heralded, and people are being called to repent. If we're going and sharing this, that means we are an expression of God's dominion in the earth. So of course, the world would want us to leave that doctrine on the shelf. You have to know that there are people today who would claim to be Christians but don't believe in the resurrection. You do know there are people who want us to present Jesus as a great teacher and as a morally a good influencer in culture, but not as the one who raised from the dead after being publicly crucified, who preached for 40 days in his resurrected body, who ascended on high. They don't want us to talk about the miracle that gives us the reality and the understanding that he is truly divine, so we should worship him. They want us to put that on the side, because if that message keeps being shared, if that message keeps being spoken, if that message keeps being given to person after person, then the Lord is glorified and the movement is stronger than ever. Go quickly. Tell others that he is risen, and know that the going and telling, the command that came with the message of the resurrection for the women at the tomb, is just as much a command for Christians today. That's why there are Christians today, because since the resurrection, the message of the resurrection has been spread and souls have been saved. Now, I know messages like these can come with some fear, right? Because we feel this challenge and this pressure to share the message of the resurrection with others. And what we start thinking about is, how are they going to receive it? What are they going to say? And what can I do to say it the right way? Some people may mock me. What if they don't believe what I'm saying? And look, the word of God is such an awesome encouragement for us because it gives us the examples of instances where people obey the command to go and tell that he is risen, and they came to a people who didn't want to hear what was said or didn't receive it the right way. Guess what, y'all? The disciples were those people, the 11. They heard the message that Jesus was risen from the women who were at the tomb, and they didn't believe it. Luke chapter 24, verse 10 through 11 shows us this. This is another account of what took place after the resurrection. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. The very disciples heard the message of the resurrection and did not believe when they heard it. You know what's even crazier? Other accounts of the scripture shows that more people came to tell the disciples and they did not believe that Jesus actually appeared among them, and they still were in disbelief. They were like, this is a weird spirit or something. What is going on? It's going to happen. Everyone's not going to receive this message right away. But the disciples help us out here because it lets us know that if we go and tell that he is risen, if we go and share the message of the resurrection with others and they don't receive it at first, it doesn't mean God won't reveal it to them later. That's the testimony of the scriptures, that eventually Jesus opens the minds of the disciples so they would know who he is, even though the message came to them several times and they didn't believe. And I want to encourage you. When you are anxious about sharing this message and about how it will be received and what work it will do in someone's life, be like the women who were at the tomb. Have comfort in knowing that you did what God told you to do by sharing it, and have comfort and rest in the fact that Jesus is going to take care of the rest. That just because someone rejected what you said to them about the gospel, about the risen Messiah in the first interaction, it doesn't mean that Jesus won't reveal himself to them later. And it doesn't mean that we should stop telling that message. The women did what they were supposed to do. They obeyed the command from God to go and tell, and God took care of the rest. And this is the encouragement that all of us should have with going and telling the message of the resurrection, that he is risen. God will reveal himself to those who we engage with this message in due time. Don't give up, Christian. Just believe in his power to reveal himself and do your part. Know that God will take care of the rest. Now, I know some of y'all like, hey, Pastor Ben, I hear you on that, but that's not what I'm struggling with in this moment. That's not what I'm afraid of in this moment. That's not what messes with me in this moment, because I'm really just struggling with having to tell someone anything about it, not even worrying about how they're going to receive it. That's really what I'm dealing with right now. And I want you to understand that the picture that we see here, and it's explained in greater detail later in the passage that we're looking at. We'll talk about it next week. The picture we're seeing is of the women going to the tomb and receiving a message that Jesus is risen, and then going quickly, urgently, with fear and joy to tell it. That joy that they have on the inside It speaks to an understanding of what it means that Jesus is risen for them and for everyone else, that filled them with such great affection that it also compelled them to go and tell it. And I want to encourage you today, in light of every anxiety you can have about going and telling the world that Jesus is risen, about going and telling your friends, your families, whoever you come in contact with, whatever anxiety you have, it should be overshadowed and outweighed by the great joy of receiving this awesome message of the resurrection. Because guess what? The message of the resurrection reminds us and is really the anchor upon which we were saved. And what a good thing it is that we have come to know Jesus and be in relationship with him. The message of the resurrection has cemented Jesus as the beautiful, glorious Son of God. And to have that revealed to you and your mind and your heart, and now to live a life that is growing and nurtured from the word of God and the understanding of who Jesus Christ is, and to be able to live godliness out and to be free from a sinful, dead lifestyle, and to be able to live in worship and peace with God is such a good thing and great gift for us to have. Let that overwhelm your affections so that you can't help but share that with someone else, because you want them to experience that great gift. Let joy fuel your going and telling. Let respect and reverence, the fear part, I respect the Son of God, be there, but let joy be what overtakes. When we understand the point of this particular command that comes with the message of the resurrection, it really is just showing how central, critical, and important this message is. And the first place that it is critical and important for the believer, for each and every one of us, is in our own lives. And the more it's a good thing to us, the more we're going to want to share it with others. My encouragement for each and every one of you is to be able to spend time with Jesus in his word. Spend time gazing at the glory of the beautiful Son, thinking on what it means that he's risen from the dead and that he has saved you and brought you into newness of life, and that this newness of life is available to others, and let that build you up so that you're overflowing with telling. So that your feet start to walk and your mouth starts to talk, and you can't help but share Jesus is risen with somebody, because it's too good of a gift to keep to yourself. Let that be your anchor, overwhelming gratitude and joy about the gift that you've received. Let that be what fuels your giving the word. Not trying to receive more accolades from God because you did it. Not trying to earn your way into heaven. Not trying to be contrarian to people. But because it really is a great message. And we know that if Jesus has raised from the dead, our movement is still alive. Newness of life and disciples will be made. And there is a new creation that is springing forth in the midst of a dark world and dark times. And the revelation of the Son of God has been revealed to man so that we would be brought into fellowship and communion with God the Father through what he has accomplished. How good of a message is this, and how much should this drive us to tell the world? Just like the woman at the tomb who ran quickly to tell it. Life Church, I pray that you guys were blessed by this message and that you would go and tell someone about the resurrection. That you would pray and ask God for opportunities to tell someone about the resurrection of Jesus, to tell someone the gospel of Jesus Christ, to share that message. And not be discouraged on how they would receive it and if it would be a problem or anything, but to know that God will take care of the rest. Paul shared that message of the resurrection in Acts chapter 17. And it says that when he shared the message of the resurrection, some people mocked. Some people said, I'll talk to you a little bit more about it. And some people believed. And that's all we can expect. But are we overcome with joy like these women at the tomb with what it means for us such that it compels us to tell it? We hear the command from God and we're like, yeah, God, I want to share it. Because this is truly good news. I'm going to pray for y'all. And I pray that you guys will be able to connect with me in prayer and share after this sermon. And also that I would be able to see those of the women at small groups to be able to share with you all those things that I've learned in the sabbatical. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you, God, for your power and your might. We thank you, God, for how you continually grow us and strengthen us to walk according to your will and your way. Thank you for raising from the dead. Thank you for telling us this message such that we would know that the movement of Christianity is never dead or dying, such that we would know that newness of life is possible for those who trust and believe in you. Freedom from the deadness of sin is possible. A new creation sprouts about in our hearts and in our minds when we believe this message of the resurrection. Such that we would also recognize and know that the message of the resurrection confirms who Jesus is as the Son of God, which is the very foundation of the church, a foundation upon which we can stand boldly, strong, knowing that our Savior isn't just one who has taught us, but he's one with divine and spiritual authority and power to guide, to lead us, to intercede for us, to make us new. Lord God, help us to be overwhelmed and overcome with joy at this revelation, at this message for ourselves, that we would share it with others. And give us peace concerning those who have heard it from us before and have not yet changed. Let us remember the story of the disciples and know that you can reveal yourself to them. There's nothing too hard for you. God, help us to walk in this. We need you, God. And we know that the only way we can walk this thing out is if our eyes are gazing upon you and we are beholding the glory of the Son through the message of the resurrection. We ask all these things, trust and believe that you would do this in our hearts and our minds as a church, as a body, that we would lift up your name to the entire world. In Jesus' name I pray, amen and amen. All right, guys, I'll see you next time, and I pray you guys have a blessed day.
Well, I know that that message was truly encouraging and convicting to your heart. And my friend, if you're listening to this message right now and you realize I don't have a personal relationship, a true fellowship with Christ Jesus, I encourage you today to start your relationship and your fellowship with him today at this very moment. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that who would ever believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. And he did this why? When did he do this? Well, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. What a kindness, what a grace, what a mercy that has been extended to us as we navigate through life and try to understand, how do I become acceptable to God? How can I get to God? How can I be pleasing to God? How can I even have a relationship with God? God was the one who took the first step, that while we were sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. And we didn't deserve it, because all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But yet it was his mercy and grace that he revealed himself through Christ Jesus. He came and preached the gospel to those that were near and those that were far off. He suffered, bled, and died in our place, taking on our penalty for our sin. And God raised him from the dead. And because, and all those that trust in him, all those that believe in him, receive grace, mercy, and salvation from God, recognizing that we are sinners and that we were in need of a Savior. And it is through the work of Christ that we have come to have a relationship with God. Well, Pastor, what do I do? What do I do? How can I come into this fellowship with Christ? Believe on Christ Jesus. Believe in this message. Believe in this gospel. Believe in the word of God. Believe in the love of God that has come and been made manifest. Believe in the righteousness of God that has been revealed in the person of Christ Jesus. Know, believe that he is God and that he is fully man. Believe in him and turn away from him. Believe him. Receive his spirit. Receive him and he will empower you to turn away from your sin and to live a righteous lifestyle. Believe in the Son and turn away from your sin. You'll know this word as repentance. It means to turn away, have a different mindset, change your mind, change your course of action. Trust in God, know that God is God, and turn away from sin and say yes to God. And then connect, if you will, to a Bible-believing church. Connect to a fellowship where you can grow in that relationship, where you can grow in the knowledge of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and continue to have fellowship, sweet communion with him. I'm trying to tell you, I've been in this journey for a while, and it gets sweeter as the day goes by. Yeah, there may be tough days, but it gets sweeter as the day goes by. So, my friend, seek the Lord, call on the name of the Lord, and do it now. Let's pray together. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your kindness. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for how Christ Jesus has come into the earth to reveal to us righteousness from heaven, to reveal to us God. He is the perfect and exact imprint of the nature of God. And when we look to Jesus, we are looking into God. Jesus being fully God and fully man and manifesting the perfect will of God here in the earth. We thank God for the life of Jesus. We thank God for the person of Jesus. We thank him for his love toward us, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us and died in our place and took on our penalty, took on our sin, and he raised from the dead so that all who believe in him will be in right standing and right relationship with God. Thank you for loving us and serving us. Thank you, Jesus, for gracing us and calling us to yourself. Lord, I pray for anyone who's under the sound of my voice who does not know you, that your spirit would draw them, because no man come to the Father except the Spirit of the Lord draw them to you. Draw by your power, draw by your spirit, and draw by your word. Save that man, save that woman, save that boy, save that girl by the power of your spirit, and grow them in the faith that they will trust in Jesus and not hope in anything in this world. Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we ask all these things to be done in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. God bless you.